Hello guys, my name is Óscar Fernández. I'm a digital sculptor specialized in figures for printing. And today I would like to share with you a workflow that I think can revolutionize the creation of figures for board games or war games. I'm talking about the new Reillusion plugin called Character Creator Pose Tools. It allows us to communicate between ZBrush and Character Creator while maintaining subdivision levels, all the subtools, the ability to modify anything we want before, during, and after inside ZBrush. So there you have it. I think it's great, nothing less. Let's get to it. Well, let's see how the complete workflow would be. We'll start with an idea we have in our heads, and we'll materialize it through a two-dimensional sketch. Then we will do all the modeling in ZBrush. We'll take the finished figure to Character Creator, and using AccuRig, we will perform the automatic rigging. We'll create a set of poses with Character Creator, using the program's flexibility and precision to the fullest. Then we'll go back to ZBrush to refine the final details and make the necessary cuts and fittings for printing. We'll export the figures to STL format, and finally we'll proceed with the printing of the pieces. Let's start the project with a super basic concept of the character. And before starting to sculpt randomly, I created a quick 2D sketch to materialize what was just an idea in my head. And this is just an initial idea to start working with, and will probably change throughout the entire 3D sculpting process. However, there are some elements that I'm sure will be present in the character design, such as horns, or a helmet that integrates with the shape of the head, an armor for the torso with pointing elements to make the model more threatening, a powerful anatomy that shows the strength of our character, some fabrics to see how dynamics work in Character Creator 4, three fingers instead of five to test the auto-rigging of AccuRig, and finally, bull hooves or something like that to give our character a hybrid appearance without being exactly a minotaur. So with all this, we can start working. When I start creating a new character, I always like to define the head and the face first. And to be honest, I don't usually continue with the complete development until I find some shapes that I'm more or less satisfied with. So little by little, we start structuring the facial anatomy, adding a couple of spheres for the eyes and adding other elements like ears or a beard, which in this case will define our character a lot. Once I have all the elements, I start refining the shapes after doing a Z remesher and applying subdivision levels. Then I can add the fangs, the beard details, and finally the horns. In the end, I opted for a more organic structure for this part, so I created horns instead of a helmet or a headpiece. Alright, and once we are satisfied with the shape of the head, we can continue progressing. And to speed things up a bit, we'll use an avatar from Character Creator 4 as the base mesh for the body. We'll put it in Pose A and use the sliders to modify the proportions. And since our character will have three fingers, I'll take this opportunity to create a similar structure that I can later modify. With a simple click, we take it to ZBrush. And in ZBrush, we'll make some additional modifications to the proportions and attach the head we had previously made. To adjust the size of the head to match the body we brought in from Character Creator 4, we ensure that the model's measurements are optimized for its later use in Character Creator. Although, of course, it's something we could easily fix later on. The communication between ZBrush and Character Creator, it's not something new, but in version 3 we couldn't modify the topology of the base mesh, which was quite restrictive for creating our characters. But now, with the arrival of Character Creator 4, we can use all the typical techniques of ZBrush sculpting to make all the necessary modifications. Therefore, let's start by applying DynaMesh to create those bull hooves and define the anatomy of our protagonist. Furthermore, since we already positioned the fingers close together in Character Creator 4, we'll further streamline the creation of the hand. After achieving anatomical shapes that we are already satisfied with, we'll merge the head with the body using DynaMesh. We'll perform Z remesher to have a more organized mesh, and we'll project the details on different subdivision levels so we would have the body prepared to continue with the accessories. Alright, it's time to create our character's accessories. We'll primarily model them using Z Modeler and with a low polygon count. This way we achieve cleaner and polished shapes. We'll create all the pieces of the armor, keeping in mind that our final goal is printing. Therefore, we'll look for pieces that are either completely solid when possible, or slightly thicker than they would be in reality to avoid printing issues later on, or the piece being too fragile. In this case, creating fabric doesn't have much complexity, as there are only a couple of flaps that cover part of the legs. Using the belt as a base, we apply an extrusion, keeping only the part we're interested in, and then adjust the shape until we achieve what we're looking for. We'll then use dynamic subdivision to work with a plane to get an idea of the thickness the final piece will have. Alright, now that we've made our fabric, we have the complete block out, so if we're satisfied, we can move on to the details. Since we already have the correct topology, we just need to subdivide as necessary to add those imperfections, dents, scratches, etc., and thus give our pieces a bit more realism. Now, all that's left is to add a couple of weapons to our friend. So using the same techniques as for the armor, we'll create a battle axe and a shield, simply huge. Now we have the complete model, so let's prepare it to take it to Character Creator. Actually, this step is not necessary, but to make it look a little bit better in Character Creator, we're going to extract the UVs of the different pieces as well as the normal maps. For the UVs, we'll use the new feature in ZBrush 2023, where we can use the creased lines we have to find the cutting lines for our UV islands quickly and without leaving the program itself. We adjust them within the grid and make sure everything is fine by applying a test texture. And once we have the UVs, it's super easy to generate the normal maps too. Now we're all set to take our character to Character Creator. Alright, we're ready to take our character to Character Creator. Although we could send everything at once, I prefer to take it slow for now. I'm going to isolate only the body to send it to Character Creator using the visible option. Once the character is transferred, we see that everything is in one element while maintaining each of our subtools inside. So I'm going to load the normal maps and make everything look a bit better within the program. And I must admit, I was looking forward to this moment. Now is when we're going to see the true magic of AccuRig, the automatic rigger for Character Creator. I must confess that I have no idea about rigging, and this tool seems like pure sorcery to me. We press the Create Guides button, the tool starts analyzing the mesh, and it automatically places the joint points in a way that, to be honest, is quite accurate. Now we just have to adjust the placement of those points by pressing on each of them, and using the diagrams we have at the top. We can use a symmetry function to work faster, or deactivate it if our character is not symmetrical. We define the number of fingers for our character, in our case 3, and we click Generate Skeleton. And Viola, skeleton generated in literally 2 minutes. The next step is to configure the arrangement of the fingers. So we'll adjust the position of the dots for each joint, and we also define the direction of a special point in the thumb, which indicates the rotation of this particular finger. We make sure everything is fine and press the Bind Skin button. With that, again, the program will calculate the weight of the skin that surrounds each joint so that everything deforms smoothly. Once the complete skeleton is generated, we're going to check it with an animation to see how it behaves. The anatomy of this character is a bit special, and I think I didn't place this point in the correct position, so the shoulders end up being too forward, but that's not a problem, we'll accept it anyway. Using Pose Offset, we can finish adjusting those peculiarities that depend a bit more on the morphology of our specific character. So I adjust the position of the shoulders, the tilt of the torso, or the separation of the legs manually. For someone like me, who is used to only working with static figures, seeing your character come to life, it's just amazing. And now that we have everything ready, we can save our Character Creator project. Let's continue adding accessories to Character Creator 4, as if we were dressing our character from the inside out. So now it's time for fabrics. Once again, working with this type of element is super easy. First, we have to mention that we have to work with planes, and we're going to define the parts that will deform and the parts that won't, simply with polypaint. As if it were a mask in Photoshop or Substance, We're going to paint the whole piece in white and protect with black color the parts that we don't want to deform when applying dynamics. Since we have a very low polygon count, we can achieve very smooth gradients by just slightly smoothing the paint. We take the UVs of each piece and texture map from PolyPaint. We launch the flaps, again using the visible button. In Character Creator, we can import them as individual accessories and adjust them to the body. We delete the color map, link all the pieces to the hip, and test that everything works correctly. Perfect! Now we just need to activate physics for each piece and load the weight maps that we just generated with PolyPaint. Our pieces already behave like fabrics, but we need to define which parts of the character they will collide with. So we select the body and define the collision volumes for the hip and legs in this case. Deforming the capsule simply using the gizmo for now is enough. Let's move on to the armor. To bring the armor pieces to Character Creator 4, we follow the same process we've used so far. We isolate each piece we want and press visible again. We import each subtool as a new accessory and go to the texture panel to load the normal maps in each of them. I must say that this step isn't really necessary, but it makes everything look a little better. Since I'm importing the elements in different stages, I have to place them manually and link them to their corresponding joint, which is something that's not necessary if we import everything together, as the program would do its calculations automatically. In any case, it's super quick. Just select each element and press the Pick Parent button and click on the joint to which it will be linked. Activate the fabrics again to have all the accessories visible and check how they behave with the test walking animation that we've been using so far. I can't hide it even if I wanted to. It's alive. To add the weapons, we follow the same process. In ZBrush, isolate the axe, launch it using visible, and import it into Character Creator as a prop in this case, so we'll have a single element with all the subtools inside. Set the pivot point to the center of the axe, place it in the hand using the gizmo, and check how it behaves. Finish equipping the character by following the same steps for the shield, and we have completed the entire process. So we have everything ready to start playing with poses. We all know that posing a character in ZBrush is perfectly possible, but it requires a considerable amount of effort and time. Therefore, creating a set of various poses for the same character can become quite tedious. Thanks to Character Creator, AccuRig, and the Character Creator Pose Tools plugin, we'll have seamless communication with ZBrush and make small changes as well as create a completely new pose. It's going to be a task that's not only quick, but also fun. In addition to manually posing our figure, we can use ActorCore, which is an immense library of ready-to-use movements in Character Creator, which we have on the Reillusion website. In our case, we are going to use some animations from this library, and the best part is that we can capture a specific frame of the animation to create unique and dynamic poses. We can save that exact frame and create our own library of poses within Character Creator. We're going to use the animation as a general base for our pose, selecting the exact moment we want to capture. Then we make adjustments using the pose editor. I think it's important to highlight how easily we can pose the hands, moving each phalanx in a quick and intuitive way. And we could even save the hand gesture to use in future poses. For example, in this case, the grip of the shield, or use some of the ones we already have in our library to further streamline the process. First of all, let's create a quick base to position the character. I always try to make the bases tell a story that goes beyond what the character itself conveys. But in this case, we're just going to create a simple base for playing. Alright, and finally, it's time to bring all the poses to our ZBrush project. Yes, you heard right, all of them in the same project. We apply the pose, select all the elements, go to Plugins, and within ZBrush Pose Link, we choose to send the current pose. The plugin automatically starts analyzing the correspondence between the elements in Character Creator 4 and the subtools. At this point, it's very important that none of the subtools have been renamed and that they have exactly the same name as in Character Creator 4. Now all the subtools deform and move to the correct position automatically, so we can move on to the next ones. What's really happening is that each pose corresponds to a layer in ZBrush that is created for each of the subtools where all the changes are stored. The different poses are shown in this track and we can rename them. By clicking on each of them, the layer is activated to show the changes, and we can edit each pose individually, but also to make adjustments to the anatomy, for example, or to make small modifications to the position of accessories. And each of these changes will be stored for each of the poses. Once the file is saved as a project, we can open it in a subsequent session. It may seem like we've lost the poses. However, we can see that the layer information is still active. So all we need to do is press the refresh button on the pose list to have them all available again. In the layers panel, we can see that for each subtool, we have a layer whose name corresponds to the name of the pose, and it will be automatically activated when we select the pose to which it's linked. Well, that's it. This has been the result of our work. Once the figure in pose A is done, I think the process of generating the four poses and trying at least 10 more that I finally discarded didn't take me more than an hour. Furthermore, I also created a bust from one of the existing figures. Next step, printing. Alright, now all that's left is to prepare the figures for printing. And the first thing we're going to do is give thickness to the skirts because, as we mentioned before, the physics in Character Creator needs to be applied with the accessory in the form of a plane. We give it thickness, apply the texture, and it's done. The next thing I'm going to do is make sure that the entire figure is a solid mesh and that there are no gaps between the different subtools. We convert each subtool into a single polygroup, we merge all the subtools into a single mesh using remesh by union, and we separate the pieces using the polygroups. We close the holes that are left, and now we can perform the fittings. Once the fittings are created, we slightly inflate the subtools that have the male fitting, and we create the final pieces using Boolean operations. We apply a decimation to reduce the polygon count and be able to smoothly bring it to the slicer without issues. We add a solid object that will define the scale for all the figures and export it as an STL. In this case, we will use G2Box to add the supports and prepare the pieces for printing. Whenever I can, I try to manually add the supports. It's a super boring job, but it ensures that the pieces have fewer marks when removing the supports, and that the supports are only where they are really needed. For pieces where I'm not concerned about marks when removing the supports, I add automatic supports. Once the printing is finished, we remove the pieces from the print bed, we join them with cyanocrylate and viola. So this is the final result of the printed pieces. I printed the figures at what would be the 75mm standard, more or less. Much larger than pieces for board games, but a size highly requested by painters. Well, that's all for me. As I mentioned earlier, I believe this workflow can really revolutionize the creation of figure sets, even armies for board games. Before, what held me back as an artist was that in previous versions of Character Creator, we had to rely exclusively on the original mesh topology. Now, however, we have total freedom to create our own creatures, rig them with AccuRig, and then pose them with Character Creator. So the combination of ZBrush, AccuRig, and Character Creator will not only greatly increase productivity in our work, but it will also allow us to continue with all our creativity and all our freedom as artists. Alright, that's it. I hope you enjoyed this. Greetings, and goodbye.